Good afternoon, friends. It's my pleasure and privilege to welcome you all for this distinguished lecture series number 14 on energy efficiency today. We are privileged to have Mr. Saurabh Kumar, Executive Vice Chairperson of Energy Efficiency Services Limited, to be here with us deliver this lecture. As many of us know, Mr. Saurabh Kumar is the Executive Vice Chairperson of the ESL Group. The last one decade, ESL has phenomenally transformed the energy efficiency market in India with their innovative models, with accelerated energy efficiency in various sectors, including municipality, agriculture, and also industry. The way they have forged international partnerships in delivering accelerated energy efficiency is phenomenal. And in the recent times, ESL has also been focusing on new and emerging areas such as smart metering, regeneration, electric vehicles, renewable energy, and is playing a very, very important role in India's low carbon development journey. Mr. Saurabh Kumar was formerly with the Income Tax Department, the Ministry of Power, and the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. In terms of his contribution to energy efficiency in India, the way the LED market has been transformed by Mr. Saurabh Kumar and ESL has been phenomenal. Many of us know the program Ujala, the popular name of the LED program, and the streetlight national program have all been handled extremely well and have contributed significantly to national energy efficiency under the leadership of Mr. Saurabh Kumar. And Saurabh Kumar and his team have successfully implemented several demand side measures and transformative initiatives in many areas, as I mentioned earlier. Mr. Saurabh Kumar is an alumni of Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur, and National Graduate Institute of Policy Studies, Tokyo, Japan. I have to mention one small coincidence before I hand over the stage to Mr. Saurabh Kumar. Coincidence, they say, is God's way of remaining anonymous. We have a rare coincidence in Mr. Saurabh Kumar that he shares the date of birth with the National Energy Conservation Day. No wonder that his contribution to energy conservation in India has been phenomenal. Stage is yours, Mr. Saurabh Kumar. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Venkatesh, first of all, for very kind words, and I don't know if I am suited for whatever you have said, but very, many thanks. Just one technical thing, I don't think I have a slide share authorization. So in case you have yours, I've sent the slides if you want to post it up. I can't share it because I'm not authorized. Either you can give me that. Now it has come. Thank you. So let me first thank CII, Mr. Venkatgiri. It's always a pleasure, privilege to be with him. The topic that has been that Mr. Venkatgiri suggested, it's a very important topic, has been of relevance for the last two decades, remains relevant even now, is what is the ESCO market? What stops that the ESCO markets has had. So if you all agree, I have a small presentation that I wanted to take this conversation forward. Also, any participant wants to stop me and ask questions, feel free to do so. Let me just share the presentation. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, sir. Yeah, we are able to see.
So let me first turn to what is the Indian market potential, and this is based on a study, I think one of the most comprehensive studies that I've seen, and I've quoted this study done by Shakti Foundation and ACEE, which is the Alliance for Energy Efficient Economy, did this study. A very wide-ranging study, we also contributed. It puts a number of 93,000 to 120,000 crores as the market potential, comprising largely of buildings, agriculture, municipal street lights, and industry. So this is it's a very large market. The study proposes some things that need to be done. And I'll not mention them right here because I have dealt with them in my other parts of the presentation. But I'm just quoting from this study, and I would recommend those interested in knowing what what the challenges of the ESCO markets are, how can we turn it to a $1 billion ESCO market. It was done in 2017, but I think whatever it has addressed, whatever it has analyzed, and whatever it has recommended is still very, very, very relevant in today's times. So, my own experience and looking at the fact that I have been in this space for now nearly 15, 17 years, where we have tried to do whatever we could. If you see the market today, there is very little ESCO activity outside of what we have done. What we also see, and the same report, in fact, reports earlier when I was in the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, we had the same set of challenges. Most ESCOs are very, they hardly have any capital. The Shakti Foundation reports indicate that the maximum team sizes for ESCOs is 25. And with the twin things of not having too many people, capacity is limited, no capital, obviously it limits itself to smaller little projects and is not able to scale up. The third bullet is something which really is at the heart of why ESCO market has not evolved. And let me give you my own example. Before I joined ESL, IFC, which is the private sector arm of the World Bank, was helping two states, Odisha and Rajasthan, to develop a streetlight ESCO PPP model. Now, as everyone knows, streetlights are the easiest way of the sector where ESCO models can run. They are standardized lights which run for exactly the same time before and after the changeover. Yet, what were the challenges? And the challenge was, let me give you an example of Rajasthan. 2015, when we started working on the Rajasthan streetlight project, we got an inventory from the state government that said they had 15 lakh streetlights. We have done 99% of work there, except for about 20,000 lights that the private operator under an IFC guided contract has done. Would you believe the total number of lights are 9 lakhs? Now, that's the first point that I wanted. Number two, streetlights are the rating of a streetlight depends upon the road width. So it ranges from, let's say, highways, which, as per the National Lighting Code, need certain level of lux, about 32 to 36, down to small alleys and where the requirement is put much less. In all, there are about 4 or 5 different wattages, whichever lighting technology that you use. So typically in a municipal body, there is a combination of these lights that, for example, highways will be 5%, large roads will be, let's say, 10, 15, 20%. Mostly are these small lanes which comprise of 40 to 50% of lights. Mostly, if you recall, where the street lights have not changed, and now it's a rare phenomenon, and we are very proud of the fact that we have replaced 1.2 crore street lights in the country out of a potential 1.4 when we started off. So most of the lights in the small alleys, which are normally residential complexes and areas, used to be tube lights. So I gave you an example of Rajasthan. I'll give you an example of South Delhi. South Delhi, we signed up in 2016, and they gave us an inventory of 1.9 lakh streetlights, where 1,20,000 streetlights were supposed to be tube lights. Now, when we actually did the project, would you believe the number of tube lights were actually 1/3? So what I'm trying to mention is that the baseline data, which is critical to any ESCO project, is either non-existent or is horribly wrong. And that's why before we started off streetlight projects, there were projects in Hyderabad, there were projects in Ludhiana, there were projects in Indore, all ended up in litigation because what was given to the private operator, the number of lights and the inter-say rating of lights was very different from what it was when you go to the ground. And that leads me to the next point that typically energy efficiency, as we all know, is an intangible asset. You can't measure energy efficiency. Unlike renewable energy, where you put up a solar panel and you have a meter, there is no dispute. But in energy efficiency, it is a combination of what equipment you're installing and the number of hours that you use that equipment for. Now, take a look at a building. A typical government building, let's say 10,000 square meters, would possibly, and I'm talking about a government building where there is no central air conditioners, the total investment size of that project will be less than a crore. But because of the fact that you have to have a baseline, you have to have a measured measurement and verification protocol, that may end up being about 20 to 30 lakhs itself over a period of 3, 4, 5 years. And therefore, disaggregated ESCO projects actually fail because the transaction cost of monitoring and project development is very high. Then, of course, there is very low levels of awareness. People don't know that a thing like an energy service company exists, and therefore people try and do this in their own capacities, and because the numbers are small, the prices that they get for efficient equipment is high, the paybacks are longer, and therefore the replication goes up. One thing that I showed you in the first slide, one of the recommendation, and I'll come back to this, that there is no standard ESCO contract issued by any entity in India. We can issue it potentially, but we are a commercial entity ourselves, and therefore it is inappropriate for ESL to standardize a contract. And that also makes a hell lot of a difference in the way various stakeholders, whether it is the bank, whether it is the facility owner or the distribution company, looks at any ESCO projects. This last point is something which, again, we'll discuss in some detail. There are no targets. Except the PAT scheme, as we all know in the industry, the Government of India Bureau of Energy Efficiency has issued targets which are rolling in nature of 3-year period, and which makes, which at least theoretically enables that sector to procure an ESCO. And this is the vicious cycle that has led to constant market failure as far as India is concerned. The second element that I would turn to is what are the challenges of financing? As I said, there has been plenty of efforts done by the Government of India, Bureau of Energy Efficiency, various financial institutions like SIDBI, and to some extent us to promote ESCOs. For instance, between 2007 and 10, the Bureau of Energy Efficiency came out with a program to accredit ESCOs. We hired rating agencies like CRISIL and ICRA to get an independent rating of whatever number of ESCOs existed. On the side of it, we also funded large number of project development, DPRs were made in the hope that states and other facility owners will utilize the services of these ESCOs. Third leg was creating a financing platform where several large banks and financial institutions joined, and they committed to the Bureau of Energy Efficiency that they will lend, and to make them feel slightly more confident and secure, a partial risk guarantee fund was also set up, which took care of 50% of the lending that a bank would do to a. But still, having done all this, we still know the activity did not turn. What did SIDBI do? Very similar thing to the partial risk guarantee fund. They set up a partial risk sharing facility, very similar to the B scheme, but slightly different in terms of coverage. But there was an institutional problem there. SIDBI, being a body incorporated by a law of parliament, was constrained to not provide guarantees to anybody other than small enterprises. And therefore, yet again, the problem of sizing a project, the kind of ESCO that they can provide guarantees to, came back, and we don't have any traction as far as this project is concerned. Among the three, perhaps we were the most successful, but possibly, hopefully, short of what was expected. Once again, with the help of IFC and a very positive positively inclining Odisha government, we structured a program where ESL set up a SPV. The payment risk was taken over by ESL with the help of the state government, who allocated capital for this. And then we bid out the SPV itself. And today that SPV is functional. We are only a 24%, 26% stake in that. And the private operator who won the bid replaced about 50,000 lights, but was not able to get more capital from wherever it had promised, so that we were not able to replicate and scale up this model. Also, in many other states, states were unwilling to provide the kind of financial support and security that the Odisha government did. And therefore, what if you ask me personally, what is the basic barrier? I think there were lots of efforts done towards loan side of it, guarantee side of it, project structuring side of it. But I think what is needed if you really want ESCOs to come up is some sort of an equity fund for ESCOs. We also, second learning is that small projects and does not work. As I mentioned in my last slide, it gets into a vicious circle because of inadequate capacities. And I spoke about the baseline data challenges. But if you ask me to prioritize, one of the most important requirement is the equity that is needed for ESCO. Let's see how. I mean, this is energy efficiency is something which has similar kind of an experience worldwide. Maybe we are in the start or maybe a few steps that we've taken. What did US do? US in the early 90s and 2000s mandated that all their federal buildings will reduce their energy consumption by X percentage over a period of time. And this they made it as a law. And they also said that ESCOs will be the way in which this would be done. They standardized the monitoring and verification protocol, which is the IPMVP, and they standardized the whole set of documents that was needed for this. And we had one of the best rollout of the ESCO program. Today, the ESCOs are doing extremely well. It has become a part of normal business proposition. Same thing in Europe. Europe also came out with long-term and high targets, 20% reduction by 2020, 30% by 2030. They also introduced what is called the white certificates. White certificates are very similar to energy saving certificates and the PAC. And the third important thing that they did in Australia also followed suit is that they started giving ratings to buildings based on their efficiency. And therefore, the market suddenly transformed towards efficient building, because the rent, if I had a 5-star building, I would get a better rent than a 4-star building. And this helped in moving the market very, very quickly. China is again something that was done by World Bank, where they standardized a model for shared savings. They mandated in their 5-year plans energy efficiency targets, made energy efficiency as a priority sector link. Now, that also then made sure that the banks who are otherwise reluctant to move in have to understand energy efficiency, have to fund this. Brazil did something which is very similar to what US has also done, is the utility DSM, where they said that if your revenues of a utility is 100 million, for example, 5% of it you will have to spend on energy efficiency and DSM. They created lines of credit for ESCO. They also ensured that there is a strong ESCO association. Nearer home, and this is something which has happened in the last 4 or 5 years, and we are very proud to be associated with Saudi Arabia in the rollout of their super ESCO. So they set up a super ESCO. A super ESCO simply is an aggregator for ESCOs. And what both the countries did was to give mandates to facility owners, like municipal bodies, commercial buildings, that you have to do. For example, in Saudi Arabia, the target to all municipal bodies is to change over to LED streetlights in a time-bound manner using the ESCO. And that's how the Tarsheed or Etihad ESCO aggregates demand, provides the payment comfort to ESCOs, and then it becomes a market player and a market force which carries on. Now let me turn to our story. If I were to point out five, six things that we were able to beat the trend. Number one, we were very well capitalized by the government. Our equity capital is 1,000 crores. We were able to aggregate demand. We had a model which was very simple and flexible and with very innovative financing instruments. What we were able to back up is with a strong and speedy implementation of any projects on the ground. Of course, the government helped us to access multilateral and bilateral loans, and also technical assistance, because many of the new things that we did, even to begin with Ujala, no one had done that before anywhere in the world. And therefore, there was no literature to go back on. And therefore, to put commercial money in such uncertain sectors is also not the right thing. And therefore, the technical assistance, pilot grants also helped. We made something to make energy efficiency, I call it visible, but tangible. And I'll show you how we did that by through public dashboards, which A, increased the interest in all our schemes, and B, it also reduced the dispute that I've not had the savings, because all that data was captured live and put out through a transparent process on our website, for example. And we created thought leadership to venture into new areas on similar models. May not necessarily be energy efficiency, because, and how we did that is that we looked at why in a particular sector the intent and the actions of actors have not yielded the result. And I'll give you one example, that is of smart meter. Now, smart meters has been on the agenda of the government for over a decade now. The National Smart Grid Mission was set up in the first decade of 2000 of the century. It tried for 14 or 15 pilot projects across the country, but could not succeed. So it was out of inquisitiveness, when we were asked to take up this project, we went through why these things did not happen. And we were able to pinpoint the real reason. And the real reason, if you ask me, is a smart meter is an electronic meter which can communicate. It's as simple as that. Now, there are three communication methods that are allowed under the present technical specifications of the BIS as far as smart meters are concerned. One is GPRS, like a SIM card that you and I have on our mobile phones. The second is RF, radio frequency, and the third is power line communication. Most attempts were made on RF and PLC. Now, RF, as you know, is an unregulated network, and therefore each operator would like to have its own encryption for data security. Number two, and therefore because of that, what happens is in RF, you have to set up your own communication system, right? Most states who tried to do this, A, were not able to standardize, B, unable to bear the additional cost. Just to give examples, today, a GPRS meter costs 2,200 rupees. And today, an RF meter costs about 6,000 rupees. The advantage with GPRS is that there are credible, secure operators like Jio, Airtel, Vodafone, who do this for the living. And they'll give you, if you have an SLA, they will give you the results as you desire. And we found this to be the biggest challenge and barrier. We decided to adopt GPRS. And today we are the largest smart meter operator in this country. Demand aggregation will not spend much time. When we started off, we were hardly there in the world state, just about 0.1% of global demand in 2013-14, which very quickly in 2 years' time became 12%. I'm told now it is much more. What has been the impact? Most of the people know we distributed 37 crore LEDs, another 150 crore. Or more part of the private sector, because A, the Ujala program helped in dissemination of this information that LEDs are good. and good for everyone. The prices fell, and therefore the retail prices fell, and when domestic manufacturing increased. We carried this demand aggregation model to many places, which is not talked about because it is not as dramatic as the LED bulbs. Street lights, we've done 1.2 crores. The price reduction has been 65%. And unlike the Ujala program, where we were like a trader, here we are managing these lights for 7 years. Similarly, smart meter, we were able to reduce prices by 50%. And I'll come to why I'm saying this in the slides that will come. Electric vehicles, we found just a 2000 procurement resulted in 15% reduction in prices. Charging stations, same. And we have just started a program which is, we call the Gram Ujala program. It's again a very innovative program which leverages carbon credits to reduce the cost of bulb, and this would be available only to the rural India. The second reason out of the 6-7 things that I highlighted was our business model. We made it easy for people, for stakeholders to join the program at a very low transaction cost, which is, it's a model that will because of aggregation, because it is very simple, no state government, no municipal body has to provide any upfront capital. They pay us from as a share of savings. And this is the pay-as-you-save model. And this was split into two for efficient equipment. It was an on-bill payment where you take an LED bulb or a fan, at, let's say a fan at 100 rupees, and you keep paying 100 rupees over the next 2 years, 3 years to your electricity bill. ESCOM model I've already spoken about. We also made sure that we provided training and capacity building, which is very important, particularly when we are managing such large volumes of disaggregated assets. And of course, as I mentioned, multilateral bilateral loans through the Government of India of over 2 billion also helped. I mentioned about making energy efficiency visible. On the left-hand side, you will see our Ujala dashboard. Of course, now, the scheme from our side is stopped because we feel we have done our bit and private sector has taken over. There's no need for us to take it forward. But if you and I've indicated the web pages where you can find this, this is publicly available. On the right hand side is the street light, 1.2 crore street lights. If you click on any state, you will get into a state dashboard, and and there, all the municipal bodies, urban local bodies, even with 1,000 lights are all there. You click on any one of the urban local bodies, what comes out is a Google tagged map of the city where we have installed lights. It also indicates how many lights were installed, how many lights are working, how many lights were off, and what has been the cumulative consumption over time. This we do by putting smart meters on the switching points of all these places. It also helps us manage the street lights because, as you know, before we took over, before it was manual, the street lights were operated on a 12-hourly basis, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Sorry, 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Now, as you know, we really don't need public lighting for 12 hours. We have calculated that the average over the year lighting public lighting requirement is not more than 10 to 10 and a half hours. And therefore, we have put timers through in that smart metering system to have the lights on and off as per the daylight which is available in a particular city. So an additional 15 to 20% savings is happening. But why this is important very, very much is that the dispute that we saw in ESCO projects before ESL was able to come in, have practically been reduced to zero. And we follow this dashboard model in virtually all our programs, whether it is smart meters, whether it is electric vehicles or the buildings program. It helps us in a way that we remain lean as an organization and still manage large projects. And also it helps in being transparent. So my last slide, basically, what is it that we can do to resurrect ESCO? And based on the international experience, ESL's experience, my own experience, first as a public policy proponent in BE, and now as an active in the commercial field, we need to have energy efficiency goals for all states. There is a demand side management policy and regulation that most states have adopted. I think there needs to be targets set for energy efficiency, ESM, very much like Brazil has done, very much like the US has done, and this should be monitored by the Electricity Regulatory Commission. It should also set up a DSM resource fund in each utility. Now, I have suggested 2 to 5 paisa per unit. It could be even 1 paisa per unit, 2 paisa per unit, which can be socialized to all consumers. This could potentially lead to a creation of a fund at the national level of up to 10,000 crores. Bureau of Energy Efficiency, SDE, should help utilities in creating a pool of projects, very simple, efficient equipment, aggregate all buildings, aggregate pumps, whether it is a water pump or a sewage pump, and then through a transparent bidding, select private ESCOs. The fund that has been created could be used to pay for these services and the risk guarantee funds that are available even today can be leveraged to reduce the cost of borrowing. The third thing is, and all of this can be done together. You would also have credible certificates like Europe has white certificates and increase the visibility of the PAT scheme to include white certificates. This will then have a much larger pool of actors who can come in. You will then get new product like derivatives and so on and so forth. But what is really needed is standardization of contracts, basically by BE and SDA. I would never recommend that ESL should do that because we are ourselves are interested commercial parties. So we should not be allowed to do a standardization of contract. And of course, Government of India, BE can help in mobilizing funds through the PFIs. And not just lines of credit. I've said this in the past. We also need equity support through a venture capital fund or any other fund that the government will have to come up with. So this is where I would like to stop and would be happy to take any questions if there are any.
Mr. Saurabh Kumar, thank you. Thanks for an excellent address. You started by talking about the market size and the opportunities for ESCOs, aptly summarized the challenges that ESCOs faced. Also spoke about international experiences, and those were something very relevant to the kind of markets that we are related to. ESL's experiences and its successes and way forward. Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Saurabh Kumar, for your address. There are quite a few questions which have come up. I can summarize the questions and maybe look forward to your response. The first question was quite interesting, Mr. Saurabh Kumar. In the last 12 years, almost, of ESL's existence, there have been a lot of successes. Where do you see ESL in the next 12 years? What are the next big programs that are expected? What are the next key programs that are coming up for the country?
Okay. Thank you very much. Very, very relevant question. And we have also changed the way we have been doing things in the last 10 years, looking at what this next decade beholds. Now, if you ask me, next decade will have three main issues that the energy sector will have to grapple with. First is climate change, foremost. Next is very large renewable energy ambition, greening the grid, as they say. And the third is electric mobility. The way we are seeing the transitions to take place is that the traditional way in which electricity sector has been seen in the last one century will undergo a complete transformation. And we are already seeing that. Consumers becoming prosumers, decentralized generation becoming more and more common. And with your EVs coming in, they will be not just used for transportation, but will also be used for storage. Because as you know, as you move ahead with so much of renewable energy ambition, you will need storage actually yesterday, if not tomorrow, to stabilize the grid. And therefore, what we have done is that we have come up with a concept, a very unique concept called convergence. We see these three sectors, which are traditionally being looked after by different, not just ministries, but also different kind of businesses. But there is a need for an overlap, not just at the regulatory and policy level, but also at the commercial level. So we have come up with something very unique, and happy to report we have started a project in Goa. And let me spend a couple of minutes. You may have heard of the Kusum scheme of the Government of India. Now, the whole idea behind is every year the states put together give out an agriculture subsidy of more than 1 lakh crore. And even that is given at a normative value of about 4 rupees per unit. But if you look at the cost of service of the discounts in agriculture, it is nothing less than 7 rupees per unit. So therefore, A, they are bleeding because of this. So therefore, the government decided to incentivize through a capital subsidy solar farms. Unfortunately, the offtake of the scheme, despite the fact that 30% capital subsidy has been promised from the Government of India, 30% by the state government, and 30% loan has been arranged through NABARD. Yet, we do hardly see any offtake in any of the states, except for a few, couple of states, Haryana, Punjab, where the farmers are more affluent. What is the reason? The reason is very simple. If I'm getting electricity for free, which I am as a farmer, why should I pay even 10%? So I don't care about your 90%, but why should I pay your 10%? And I'm not interested in your climate change. And I'm an ordinary farmer. I'm more worried about my crop. So we said, we can achieve the same policy goal if you disengage pumps with the solar panel, right? And this is the concept of convergence. So we were doing a project in Maharashtra where we are putting up to 2 megawatt of power, solar power plants right at the next vacant place of these rural substations. So we said, you want to realize your policy goal of A, solarizing the agriculture feeder, and B, using efficient pump. I'm giving you power at 3 rupees per unit. Give me 50 paisa more, amortize that the cost of pump on my power purchase agreement. At 3 rupees 50 paisa, I'll replace all the pumps in that area. So you achieve the same goal without the farmer having to do anything. So this first MOU we have signed, in fact, the project agreement has been signed with Goa, where we are putting up 110 megawatt of solar, and about 8,000 to 10,000 pumps will be replaced. They went on and added 2 more things. They said, we also want to provide induction cook stove to rural areas. Another 2 paisa added to the power purchase agreement. They want to give 4 LED bulbs each free of cost to the rural area. Another 8 paisa added, 3 rupees 60 paisa is still lower than their average cost of supply. So this is the convergence model that we are now doing. That's number one. Next priority, of course, is smart meter, that we are the largest operator. We are presently replacing about 1 crore smart meters. And third is electric mobility. We have played some part in 4-wheelers. We want to play a larger part in 3-wheelers and buses and charging infrastructure. So these are the priority areas of ESM moving forward.
Thanks, sir. Thank you. The next point that you touched upon was on the scale of ESCOs, sir. Currently, the scale of other ESCOs in the market are smaller, and therefore the sizes of projects that they are handling are relatively smaller. What, in your opinion, are the actions to be taken to get some of the larger players in this space? Would the vendors or technology suppliers acting as ESCOs, is that one of the models that you see happening in the next few years for the larger players to come in?
Certainly. And I would not restrict ESCOs to a very traditional understanding of ESCOs that they are only service companies. Of course, vendor ESCOs, I would even say financial ESCO, where you look at UK, US, particularly the smart meter programs and other programs, it is the financial institutions who create ability to do ESCO services, because it does make good money. What needs to be done, I've covered, and I'll reiterate once again, A, there has to be a mandate. look, ESL can't do this because we are not a statutory body. There has to be a mandate. If there is a mandate, then certainly people will work for it. We have seen PAT scheme before and after, and you all are in the CII, you will know the difference. Once the government mandated, there was a seriousness of action from the, and that's why I've said there is a very simple way of mandating, which is there is a DSM regulation that have been notified by virtually all ERCs. There has to be a national level effort to A, like China, like Europe, that government of India may say, and it may have also said but not notified it, that between now and 2030, I will reduce my energy consumption through energy efficiency, let's say by 20%. Allocate that 20% to all states, and that becomes a mandatory target for them. And then BE and SDF, these are the two entities who have this role, should identify low-hanging fruits, like the Ujala program. Fans are something which are very common. Have a fan replacement program. Very simple. You give 500 rupees rebate using the fund that I mentioned, and you suddenly have a wide variety of ESCOs, vendor ESCOs, and others coming up and starting this market. So what is needed is a bit of policy and a regulatory action. I think almost all other things are available in the Indian market.
Thanks, sir. There is one other question on the industry participation in ESCO markets. Industries generally are, at least the larger ones have much better credit rating than the ESCOs, the smaller ESCOs in the market today. But industries are generally reluctant to borrow for ESCO projects. Is there anything that you suggest should be done to encourage industries come forward and start looking at implementing projects through ESCO route, particularly with their capacity to access finance?
Yeah, so let me talk about large industry. I mean, the problem is with large industries, while they understand the importance of energy efficiency, they do a lot as far as energy efficiency is concerned. But it's an issue which, let me quote my ex-boss, Dr. Ajay Mathur, which he terms this into a very, very nice phrase, that it falls through the cracks when it goes from the tool room to the boat room. While the tool room, the engineers want this to happen, boardroom, the CFO says, oh, ESCO's cost of capital is 14%, I can borrow at 7. And therefore, so this has been a perennial problem, not just in India, but worldwide. Where it has worked is when you have targets, and slightly more ambitious targets, for example, in the PAT scheme, where, for example, I'm a large steel plant, I have to do capex for my two new expansions, but I have also to do energy efficiency. So I don't need to wait for my budget allocations to procure an ESCO service. So I think mandates will help. Number two, we are also seeing a very good thing in large corporates. About 50 large corporates have publicly come out and said that they would become carbon neutral by XYZ, and also have set an internal price of carbon. Now, the moment you set an internal price of carbon, then that 7% and 14% is viewed very differently by the CFO. So I think a combination of voluntary action and regulatory actions are needed really to set the ball rolling in the industrial energy efficiency.
Thank you, sir. I think there has been one question which has been repeatedly coming from many players. Is there a possibility of EESL looking up at rooftop solar as a market in terms of demand aggregation, scale up, and adoption? Is that one of the areas you might look at?
No, we looked at this area. We looked at this area. In fact, we are in the process of aggregating 50 megawatt in the state of Tamil Nadu. It's not very easy, honestly speaking. There are so many challenges that need to be done. We have been very slow because, although let me back up and say that as far as the solar market is concerned, if you look at the large solar market, there are enough players. If you look at the rooftop solar, there are again enough players. You really don't need any ESL time kind of. So we have found our way to decentralize solar. This 200 megawatt that I'm talking about in Maharashtra is spread over 190 odd sites. So it's not easy to manage such large volumes. But yes, we would be certainly happy to look at aggregation, something that NP did it so fantastically well. But then you need a statewide mandate really to come out to the rooftop aggregated market.
Thanks, sir. The other question has been on I mean, of course, you mentioned that EESL has gone global. You've been looking at other markets and helping other markets in terms of promoting ESCOSEP. One, is there an opportunity to learn some lessons from these markets? Is there anything that you've seen happening better, happening differently that we could experience? And second, is there also a market for some of the Indian players to go global, particularly when EESL is looking at some of the other markets? Is there an opportunity for Indian service providers and ESCOs to look at some of the other markets also?
So let me answer the second question first. I think if you really ask me, today, one of the biggest emerging markets is the GCC. They have suddenly, virtually all countries in GCC, including Saudi Arabia, have started looking out for energy efficiency because they know their over-dependence on oil will not be something that they would like to do. Well, so virtually every country has taken targets. It is putting out large tenders, whether aggregated or disaggregated level. It has given targets to private facility owners. So certainly, huge, huge opportunity for in the Gulf region. And of course, there are very, very good markets for ESCOs in virtually all developed countries. As far as learnings are concerned, certainly, I mean, the way forward that I've suggested is a combination of what our experiences has been and what are the best practices that we have seen in various different parts of the world, whether it is US. And that is where the recommendations of we have distilled. And yes, of course, there is always an energy efficiency. There's always a possibility, a strong possibility to learn from each other.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. You spoke about financing, sir. And one of the key topics you mentioned was the priority sector status for making more finance available. A couple of questions have been in terms of what have been your experiences. Is that initiative already taken up for discussions? What has been the response? And can we see that coming up shortly?
So, as I said, when I was a policy practitioner in the Bureau of Energy Efficiency in Power Ministry, I was one of the most vocal proponents for priority sector lending for energy efficiency. But having come to the field on the other side, what I feel is that it is not, I mean, there's no ESCO project that I know of which has not been approved because of lack of debt. What I find is the lack of equity being the biggest concern. And that's why if you ask me to prioritize, even if you do priority sector lending, you will not have enough ESCOs to really play around with. So you need to capitalize ESCOs. You need maybe a government venture capital fund. In fact, we did create a fund. Unfortunately, it went nowhere. But that was the whole idea into a decade ago, to create a fund from the budget of government of India. And you don't need thousands of crores. Maybe a couple of hundred crores is more than enough to capitalize maybe 10 ESCOs and in turn set the ball rolling. So yes, we did try, but I myself had stepped away because I felt that even if you get priority sector lending from RBI, even then it will not help because financing has never been a challenge. Availability of loan has never been a challenge.
Thank you, sir. One of the segments of industry which needs this support probably the most is a small and medium segment. Are there any plans that you are looking at, sir, in terms of reaching out to the small and medium enterprise segment? Of course, we have the LED program and the motor replacement program, but is there anything else that we're looking at for the SME industry in particular?
So a very important question. And again, SMEs in India, again, I know you and Venkat Giri are also have worked on this very extensively, are really not amenable for an ESCO intervention. Simple reason, they are informal. You don't even know whether the accounts that they are giving you are correct or not. So we, along with UNIDO, have already are implementing a project, which is a very simple project. We have selected 10 technologies in a few clusters, which are of widespread use, including motors, including variable frequency drives, some other things. What we have done is that we used UNIDO grant to demonstrate this technology in a couple of industries. And people have come and seen that this is the technology. This is how the savings work. If you agree, we will aggregate and we will provide you these equipments on an EMI basis. So this is working in a few clusters, particularly textile and a couple of other. We are just waiting to see the outcomes of it because the interest in the SME clusters and SMEs to generate interest for new technologies is not always very easy. So we're just evaluating the results and then we'll try and scale this.
Thank you, sir. I think one more set of questions has been around the DISCOM, sir. How can the distribution companies or the utilities lead the ESCO adoption in their DISCOMs, particularly given that the role of DISCOMs is very critical? Their financial status could certainly be improved if DSM could be one of the measures to be taken up. Do you see any model where the utilities could drive ESCOs, sir?
Yeah, so I suggested in my way forward that there is a DSM regulation that have been notified by virtually all regulatory commissions across the country. The problem is they have not been used. Now, if you look at Ujala scheme was done through a DSM regulation. Unfortunately, I would say there is not enough focus and thrust of the policymakers, either at the central government level or the state government level, on this very useful resource, which is energy efficiency, DSM. The way, and one good thing that the Bureau of Energy Efficiency has done of late, is to include utilities, the DISCOMs, as a designated consumer. So I think let's wait for a while, because we all know DISCOMs are in a pretty bad financial mess. But given that right kind of policy and regulatory thrust has been given in this sector, I have a feeling in the next coming 2 or 3 years, we will start seeing emphasis on DSM.
I think excellent session, sir. Thank you very much. I think these were all the questions that came from the participants, and thank you for your for sharing your experience, sharing your thoughts in terms of where the market is and what is lying in future. Maybe I can just leave it for you to conclude the session, sir. Any last thoughts, anything you would like to summarize for the session, and with that we could close the session for today, sir.
No, I think while the governments are doing what it is doing, I think my suggestion to both you and Pitgiri sahab is that while governments will do what they will do, let's, as industry, private or public, let's ourselves look at some sort of a voluntary target that we all could take, and CII can lead this activity on a voluntary basis, that this is my company or my group, I would like to reduce my energy consumption next 2 years by, let's say, 5%, and I'm willing to take the ESCO route. I think some sort of a industry-led initiative would really move the things virtually everywhere. We are trying to do a similar thing in the government, but the industry starts to do this, and small little things. I mean, for example, I'll change over all my 10% of my fleet to electric. Just an example. Make this public announcement. Let this movement where people start joining in, and then I'm sure it will become a roller coaster where everything would become easy. So that's what my closing thoughts would be. But let me thank you and Mr. Venkatgiri and all the participants for this session. It was really enjoyable. Very high quality of questions, I must say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.